Lorena, and welcome to Northcote Baptist Online this morning. It is lovely to have you here with us. I have had two exciting things happen this week that if I was seeing you in person at church, I would share them with you, so why not share them now? The first is that last Friday I got a new kitty, and so this week has been spent getting to know her, giving her lots of cuddles, introducing her to my other cat. She has brought me so much joy this last week, and she has definitely relieved the monotony of lockdown. Here is a little photo of her all snuggled up on my lap this morning while I was trying to get some work done. The second exciting thing, back in January, I decided to read through the Bible in a year. Well, on Friday, I got to the end of Revelation 22. Reading the Bible every day has been life-giving for me. With only four chapters a day, you too can read through the whole Bible in a year. But whether you read four chapters or you read a few verses, I encourage you, read the Bible daily. It will give you life. I wonder what exciting things have happened in your week. Did you go for a picnic with some friends? Did you go on an adventure tomorrow? Or maybe you celebrated a special birthday. We want to say a very big happy birthday to Eldith and to Carol, who both had significant birthdays on Friday. We hope that you feel loved and blessed, and may you know God's presence with you over this coming year. Let me share with you a poem from St. Teresa of Avila, and it's one I often come back to because I just find it encouraging. The words are so good. Let nothing upset you. Let nothing startle you. All things pass. God does not change. Patience wins all it seeks. Whoever has God lacks nothing. God alone is enough. Let's pray. Father God, we come to you this morning and we lay our burdens at your feet. We ask that you would forgive us. And we acknowledge that we need you. You are our Lord and our Saviour. You are our Creator and our Sustainer. You are our Healer and Redeemer, our Guide and our Provider. You alone are enough. You give us all we need. Lord, fill us afresh with your Holy Spirit this morning. Encourage us and empower us to go out into the world to be your hands and your feet and to share your love with our neighbours. We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us fix our gaze on Jesus this morning as we sing King of Kings and give God the honour and the glory that he deserves.
Darkness, we were waiting without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. Pray.
Your first week of school holidays been? It's been a bit different, I know. I wonder what you've been up to. We've made it outside for some tree climbing, digging in the sand, a big walk and some frisbee throwing, which has been lots of fun. Lockdown is very hard though, and we are missing our friends and family so much. And going out is a little bit complicated, and there's new rules and new things that you should do and things that you shouldn't do. And it can be a little bit difficult for adults and for kids. So we know that that can be really hard for some people. So we're thinking of you. We are really, really grateful that God loves us and tells us that He takes care of us. And when we read the Bible, we read God's promises. In Kids Rock this year, we've talked a lot about God's promises. And today we're hearing from the Jesus Storybook Bible, the story when Jesus tells the story about the sparrow. And do you remember the story? I'm sure some people will remember it. Is the sparrow worried? No. Jesus reminds those that are listening to the story that the sparrow has everything it wants and needs, just like us. Jesus wants us to know that He cares so much about us, even more than He cares for the sparrow, and we can trust Him even when life is hard or confusing. And that's a great story and a great reminder for us today. In our garden, we have lots of birds. Sometimes they're really loud and they wake us up in the morning, but we love hearing them. This week, I thought you might like to make a sparrow. We made these last year in lockdown, and mine's been sitting in the kitchen window, and it's got a little bit faded from all the sun, but it's been a lovely reminder every day just how much God loves us and wants to take care of us. So we've sent some ideas out for your families at home. Maybe you can make a sparrow and you can keep it somewhere safe in your house as a reminder to you of how loved you are and how much God cares for you. Maybe the adults in your bubble need that reminder too. And kids!
Kia kaha! We got this!
See you soon!
Bye!
The Singer. Wherever Jesus went, lots of people went too. They loved being near Him. Old people, young people, all kinds of people came to see Jesus. Sick people, well people, happy people, sad people, and worried people. Lots of them. Worrying about lots of things. What if we don't have enough food? or clothes. Or suppose we run out of money. What if there isn't enough? And everything goes wrong, and we won't be all right. What then? When Jesus saw all the people, his heart was filled with love for them. They were like a little flock of sheep that didn't have a shepherd to take care of them. So Jesus sat them all down, and he talked to them. The people sat quietly on the grassy mountainside and listened. From where they sat, they could see the blue lake glittering below them and little fishing boats coming in from a night's catch. The spring air was fresh and clear. "See those birds over there?" Jesus said. Everyone looked. Little sparrows were pecking at seeds along the stony path. Where do they get their food? Perhaps they have pantries all stocked up? Cabinets full of food? Everyone laughed. Who's ever seen a bird with a bag of groceries? No, Jesus said. They don't need to worry about that, because God knows what they need and he feeds them. And what about these wild flowers? Everyone looked. All around them flowers were growing. Anemones, daisies, and pure white lilies. Where do they get their lovely clothes? Do they make them? Or do they go to work every day so they can buy them? Or do they have closets full of clothes? Everyone laughed again. Who's ever seen a flower putting on a dress? No, Jesus said. They don't need to worry about that because God clothes them in royal robes of splendor. Not even a king is that well-dressed. Well, they had never met a king. But as they gazed out over the lake, glittering and sparkling below them, the hillsides dressed in reds, purples and golds, they felt a great burden lift from their hearts. They couldn't imagine anything more beautiful. Little flock, Jesus said, you are more important than birds, more important than flowers. The birds and the flowers don't sit and worry about things, and God doesn't want his children to worry either. God loves to look after the birds and the flowers, and he loves to look after you too. Jesus knew that God would always love and watch over the world he had made, everything in it, birds, flowers, trees, animals, everything, and most of all, his children. Even though people had forgotten, the birds and the flowers hadn't forgotten, they still knew their song. It was the song all of God's creation had sung to him from the very beginning. It was the song people's hearts were made to sing. God made us. He loves us. He is very pleased with us. It was why Jesus had come into the world, to sing them that wonderful song, to sing it not only with his voice, but with his whole life, so that God's children could remember it and join in and sing it too.
Well, kia ora. Hi, friends. I love that that story about how God doesn't want us to worry. I love the lines in that story that say God doesn't want his children to worry. God loves to look after the birds and the flowers, and he loves to look after you too. Perhaps that's a word that we need to hear again today. Of course, that's part of the story of the Sermon on the Mount, where Jesus is talking about the flowers of the fields and the birds of the air, and how God looks after them and how God looks after us as well. I guess perhaps some of us are feeling a little bit worried or anxious. Perhaps it feels like we're moving into kind of uncharted territory, doesn't it? As things start opening up again and people start moving around and we're connecting a little more and we don't know what's going to happen. But you know what? We trust in Jesus and we know that God promises to look after us. And so I want to just take a moment to pray before we come to God's word today. So let's pray together. Father, we thank you for the words of this story, the promise that Jesus makes that we don't have to be worried or anxious. That God, you know all about us. Thank you, Lord, for the words of Jesus. Also, later on when he said, come to me, all you who are heavy burdened or anxious or afraid. Bring your burdens to me and I'll give you rest. And Lord, today I want to pray for those of us who might be feeling that anxiety or those of us who are perhaps feeling a little bit burdened, those of us who perhaps might be feeling a little lonely or afraid. Lord, I pray that we could come to you, that we could bring these anxieties and burdens to you and know that you're there and you want to take those from us. Thank you, Lord, for your promise to be with us. Thank you for your promise that we don't have to be concerned or worried because you're always there with us. And Lord, now as we come to your word, I pray that you would speak to us and encourage us through your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, today I want to take you to another story. And it's found in Luke chapter 18 and verses 9 to 14. Luke 18, verses 9 to 14. If you've got your Bible, you can follow along, or you might see it on the screen as well. Then Jesus told this story to some who had great confidence in their own righteousness and scorned everyone else. Two men went to the temple to pray. One was a Pharisee and the other was a despised tax collector. The Pharisee stood by himself and prayed this prayer: I thank you, God, that I'm not like other people, cheaters, sinners, adulterers. I'm certainly not like that tax collector. I fast twice a week and I give you a tenth of my income. But the tax collector stood at a distance and dared not even lift his eyes to heaven as he prayed. Instead, he beat his chest in sorrow, saying, O God, be merciful to me, for I am a sinner. I tell you, this sinner, not the Pharisee, returned home justified before God. For those who exalt themselves will be humbled. Those who humble themselves will be exalted. And this is the word of the Lord to us today. You know, over the years, I've had a few problems with my eyes. Back about 10 years ago, I was having a real issue with one of them, and I had to go and see an ophthalmologist. That's an eye doctor. Now, this was when we lived in Japan, and of course, this created some additional challenges for me because of the language barrier. I didn't speak Japanese, and the hospital I went to didn't have a lot of English translation available either, so there was a fair bit of sign language going on. So I went along to the hospital to get my eye checked. Now, over there in Japan, you don't make an appointment and then wait for 2 months to get called up. You just turn up at the hospital and you wait your turn. And when you eventually get looked at, they're very thorough. So after about 6 hours at the hospital that day, about a dozen different eye tests, blood tests, x-rays, heart monitor tests, I'm not sure why I had all those, but it turns out I had a cataract in one of my eyes. It was causing me to look a little blurry. Actually, that came out a little wrong, didn't it? I didn't look blurry, everyone else did. The ophthalmologist told me I had an eye problem and I was going to need some surgery to have it corrected, which eventually I did, and I actually came back to New Zealand to have it done, but that's another story. I know that many of you here watching today have probably had that same kind of surgery. The story we're looking at today is a story about two characters, both of whom had major eye problems. In fact, for the characters in this story that Jesus told, their favorite word was I. Their eye was only on themselves. This is a story for all of us who have eye problems. In fact, that's how Luke introduces the story. He says in verse 9, he says, to some who were confident of their own righteousness and looked down on everyone else, Jesus told this parable. I like how the Message paraphrase puts it. He told his next story to some who were complacently pleased with themselves over their moral performance and looked down their noses at the common people. Jesus says this story is for all of us who have eye problems. The story begins with two very different individuals. These two characters in our story, the Pharisee and the tax collector, and they're both going to the temple to pray. Just a little background here will help us understand the story. Twice a day at dawn and then again at 3 p.m., a priest would make what was called the atonement sacrifice. an atonement offering on behalf of all the sins of all the people of Israel, the Jewish people. Well, this atonement service would begin outside the inner sanctuary at a great altar where a lamb without blemish would be sacrificed. This would be followed by the sounds of trumpets and cymbals and the reading of scripture. Then the priest would go inside the inner sanctuary and burn incense. And while this incense is burning, all the people outside would be praying, offering their petitions and prayers to God. So here in this story, these two men have gone to the temple to pray. It's hard to imagine two more opposite looking people, a Pharisee and a tax collector. Two men at opposite ends of the social and moral spectrum. Well, we've been talking about the Pharisees in previous messages in this series. The Pharisees were members of this group who were totally committed to holiness. They longed to be holy and pleasing to God. They wanted other people to be holy and pleasing to God as well. But their problem was not their desire to be holy. Their problem was the concept of holiness. See, they felt that they must be more acceptable to God because they were better than everyone else at keeping all of God's laws. They thought that they could accomplish personal holiness by themselves. See, for the Pharisee, holiness boiled down to conformity to rules, to following the law of Moses, and to following it as perfectly as they could. And so these Pharisees, they spent their whole lives ensuring that they kept every single last letter of the law. Now, the Pharisees knew their law. They knew the Old Testament. They studied it until they knew it backwards. Many of them could recite whole books of the Old Testament off by heart. The Pharisees were like world record holders of right living. Not only did they study the scripture and know the law, but they were so committed to making sure they kept the law that they made up a whole bunch of extra laws, several hundred in fact, to make sure that they didn't break the Old Testament law. They had laws to make sure they kept the laws. For instance, when it came to keeping the Sabbath day, which is, you know, is the fourth of the Ten Commandments, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy, they made up all these laws about what you could and couldn't do on the Sabbath. You were not allowed to work on the Sabbath. But what if your neighbor's donkey fell in a ditch on the Sabbath? Was it breaking the law if you pulled it out? So they made all these laws. When we were in Israel, when we visited Israel back in 2007, one of the hotels we stayed at had the elevator buttons programmed so that on the Sabbath, the elevator automatically stopped at every floor. This was because for the Pharisees, even pushing an elevator button on the Sabbath was considered work. That's how detailed they got in terms of figuring out what they needed to do to keep all these laws. They were absolutely committed to personal holiness. And you can hear this idea in the prayer that the Pharisee prayed, which we'll look at in a moment. Well, while the Pharisees weren't the most popular people, they would have at least been feared and respected by most people. And so this brings us to the second character in the story, which is the tax collector. Now, the tax collectors in the eyes of most people were the exact opposite. The tax collectors were Jews who worked for the Romans. They were collaborating with the enemy. They were stealing from their own people as they collected tax for the Romans. They were totally self-indulgent people. They were building their own empire. They were chasing after the pleasures in life. They got rich off the backs of the poor. Power, wealth, reputation, at least in the eyes of the Romans, was important to them. They were morally bankrupt people who wouldn't hesitate to cheat or to steal to further their own needs. If the Pharisee was respected by most people, the tax collector, on the other hand, was hated by most. And so Jesus sets up this story. It's two men. Two men with eye problems. Both of them focused on themselves. In most of the stories that Jesus tells, there's usually like a zinger or a sting in the tail, something that happens in the story that takes everyone by surprise. I'm not going to give it away this early in the sermon, but you need to understand that at this point in the story, everyone in the audience assumes that the Pharisee is a good guy and the tax collector is a bad guy. When the people heard two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector, they immediately think to themselves, I know where this story's going. Okay, so let's look at the prayers of these two. Verse 11. The Pharisee stood by himself and prayed. The Pharisee stood apart from everyone else. The Pharisee didn't even want to get close to any of the sinners around him for fear that they might contaminate him. If he were to accidentally brush up against one of the common people, he'd have to undergo an elaborate cleansing ceremony before he could continue to worship. So he stood by himself, apart from everyone else. This was a symbolic act of superiority. Now listen to his prayer. I thank you, God, that I am not a sinner like everyone else. For I don't cheat. I don't sin. I don't commit adultery. I'm certainly not like that tax collector. I fast twice a week and I give you a tenth of my income. What was the word he used most in that prayer? It was the word I, wasn't it? Eight times in this short prayer, he uses this word I. Friends, this man had eye trouble. His prayer reeks of spiritual arrogance and pride that becomes so visible when he compares himself to this tax collector or to other people. Thank God I'm not like all those other sinners. Thank God I don't have their problems. Thank God I'm not as much of a liar or a cheat as all those other people out there. Thank God I'm not like all the others in my office. Thank God I'm not like all those people I see at the gym. Thank God I'm not living how they're living. See, friends, the truth is that our hearts can be tainted with the same kind of spiritual pride and arrogance. We find ourselves thinking like that too. At least my sin isn't as bad as other people's. And we kind of feel justified by that, don't we? You know, I'm not as bad as others. We find ourselves thinking, you know, I do what God asks me to do most of the time, and we feel pretty good about that. We find ourselves thinking, you know, I respect the rules. I read the Bible. I try and live by God's rules. I come to church. Well, at least we used to. I give something in the offering. And we kind of think that makes us acceptable to God. And we look at other people and we compare ourselves to others and we think we're doing okay. But you see, the truth is that most of us have eye problems too. And so we come to the tax collector's prayer. Verse 13 says, but the tax collector stood at a distance. He stood at a distance not because he thought he might be contaminated by those around him. No, he stands at a distance as a way of saying, I am not even worthy. I have no business even being here. He stands at a distance because he knows he doesn't even deserve to be there praying. He doesn't deserve God's mercy for what he has done. And then the text says something else very strange. It says he beat his chest. He beat his chest. This kind of gesture was only used in times of extreme grief and anguish. It's so rare. In fact, it's so extreme that this action of beating chest is only recorded in one other place in the whole of the Bible. Just one other time. You know where it is? After Jesus has prayed his final prayer and died on the cross, Luke writes that all who watched this take place beat their chests, and went away. This term is a term of incredible grief, the ultimate anguish. This tax collector beat his chest, not because he's embarrassed that he got caught in sin, or out of frustration that no one likes him, or feeling sorry for himself. This man is deeply distraught over his spiritual condition. He grieves for where his heart is. He knows he's a selfish person. He knows he has an eye problem. He knows his heart is not right with God. And now we get to the heart of the story. In fact, friends, this is really the heart of the gospel. This is a tax collector's prayer. God, have mercy on me, a sinner. God, have mercy on me, a sinner. There's no phrase more central to salvation than this one. Luke doesn't use a normal Greek word for mercy here either. He uses a word that literally means to make an atonement for. As if it's to say, God, make an atonement for me. Make a sacrifice for me. Do this because I can't do it on my own. My heart is too broken. He doesn't just say, I am a sinner. The literal translation here is, God, have mercy on me, the sinner. The sinner, as if to say, I'm not just a sinner amongst other sinners. I'm not comparing myself to others. I'm not justified by my own goodness compared to everyone else. This is about me and you, God. This is about my heart. I know I've got an eye problem. Have mercy on me. He's not like the Pharisee who sees how well he's doing compared to everyone else. All he knows for sure is he has a problem that he can't fix on his own. He simply humbles himself, feels the pain of his own brokenness with nothing to offer, no promises to make. He doesn't promise to change his own life. He doesn't promise to measure up. That's the Pharisee's way. He has no confidence in himself at this point. At this point, as the incense of atonement rises up out of the temple, he offers the only plea he can make. God, may this atonement be true for me. May this sacrifice be true and good and acceptable for me, a sinner. Friends, the truth is that our hearts are a mix of that self-righteous Pharisee and that self-serving tax collector. But the good news is that Jesus, on the cross, took upon himself all the sins of the world. He didn't just become a sinner, he became the sinner. The once and for all time sacrifice for you and for me. Jesus made a way where we could not. Jesus came to deal with our eye trouble and our heart trouble, and it's sheer and utter grace. Sheer and utter grace. In order to receive it, like the tax collector, we have to repent. We have to own up to where our heart really is. God, have mercy on me, a sinner. And so we come to the zinger in the story. Jesus has set up his listeners ready to drop the sting in the tail. And this is the line that would have shocked those listening to the story. Only one of these two men had an acceptable heart. Only one of these two men went home justified. It wasn't the one who thought he was doing okay. It wasn't the one who thought his ability to keep the rules made him worthy of God's love. It wasn't the one who thought that doing the right thing is enough to be made right before God. It was the one who knew he couldn't. It was the one who knew there was nothing he could do. I tell you that this man, says Jesus, this tax collector, rather than the other, went home justified before God. See, friends, we are helpless without grace. We are hopeless without the cross. And we are humbled by God's mercy. Helpless without grace, hopeless without the cross, humbled by God's mercy. We're helpless without grace. What the Pharisee didn't understand was that religion is spelt D-O. Religion is all about what I do to appease God and make myself acceptable to him. On the other hand, Christianity is spelt differently. It's spelt D-O-N-E. See, it's not about what I do. It's about what God has done. And it begins by me realizing that I'm helpless without God's grace. That's why we sing that song sometimes, Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. In a moment, we'll close our service with that song. Friends, we are helpless without grace. And then we are hopeless without the cross. It's only through the cross, through the sacrifice of the Lamb of God who took upon himself my sin, that we can be made right with him. And we are humbled by his mercy. Right throughout the Bible, we find this picture of our God whose greatest pleasure is in forgiving our sin and showing us mercy. God loves to show mercy. In Exodus 34, verse 6, God is described like this. The Lord, the God of compassion and mercy, slow to anger and filled with unfailing love and faithfulness, forgiving sin. Yes, we are humbled by his mercy. Friends, let me ask you today, who are you more like? Are you more like that tax collector, knowing you're a sinner, knowing you are helpless without his grace, hopeless without his cross, and humbled by his mercy? Or maybe you're actually like the Pharisee with the eye problem, still thinking you're okay, still thinking you're doing better than most. Only one of them went home justified before God. Let's pray. I want to invite you today just to, maybe in the quietness of that own space where you are right now. Some of us need to pray that prayer. Let this atoning sacrifice you have made on the cross be for me. Some of us need to pray that tax collector's prayer, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Friends, in this moment, maybe you need to pray that prayer. Maybe you've never prayed it before. Maybe you've been trying to make yourself right before God. You think you're doing okay. You've been trying to keep all the rules, living right, doing the right things, and you thought that was enough. But it's not enough, and it never will be. You need to pray, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Jesus, I want to receive that forgiveness that you offered on the cross. I want you to deal with my eye problem. I can't do it. I can't make myself right before you. I know there's nothing I can do. God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Lord Jesus, we're so grateful for your sacrifice on the cross for each of us. We're amazed at the sheer and utter grace that you loved us so much that you gave up your life for us. We are so grateful that you made a way when we had no other way. So we give you our hearts again today. May our hearts be right with you. We are helpless without your grace. We are hopeless without your cross. And we are humbled by your mercy. Amen. Well, friends, it's been good to join with you again today, and I'm praying that you know that you'll know God's presence with you day by day, whatever this week might bring for you. If you want to reach out to us with a prayer request or you want to chat, please email us. You can see that on the screen. But let's enjoy this final song that's so familiar to us. And God bless you all, and have a great week.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to feel, in grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, his mercy rains, unending love, amazing. You are forever.